Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Microsoft Security Update Summary, where I will present a short recap of what was released today, February 11th, 2025. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. We're going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then I'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities that I'm covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. Before I dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months to see how it stacks up. This month, there are 58 newly disclosed vulnerabilities in the release. That's quite a bit lower than our average of around 92 and a half per month. Next, I'll talk to remote code execution vulnerabilities. These are the ones that typically provide the most risk. They will allow a threat actor to install software and other high-level activities. We've been averaging almost 37 of these per month, 36.7. This month, there are 22 remote code execution vulnerabilities in this month's release. Next, I'll talk to scoring, where Microsoft uses the Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a standardized scoring system between 0 and 10, where 10 represents the most risk. This month, the highest scored CVE comes in at 9.0 on that scale of 10. We've been averaging just around 9.6 per month over the past 13 months. As far as the average score across the entire release, all 58 vulnerabilities, that average score comes in at 7.43, which is a little bit lower than our average over the past 13 months of 7.56. Now, when we talk about CVSS scoring, it's great because it allows software vendors across different products to be able to compare and contrast vulnerabilities, even across into the hardware and firmware sides, to be able to compare vulnerabilities that a 7.43 vulnerability in one piece of software represents relatively the same amount of risk as a 7.43 vulnerability in a different product. However, it doesn't include everything there is to know when we talk about risk associated to a vulnerability. Specifically, it doesn't include things such as the severity, whether that's critical or important. It doesn't include the impact, whether that's a remote code execution, elevation of privilege, or a spoofing vulnerability. It also doesn't include whether or not that vulnerability was publicly disclosed. These are vulnerabilities where the vulnerability itself has been publicly disclosed prior to release. That could happen in a few different ways. It could be something such as a researcher blog where they go into details with the proof of concept and allow threat actors to then be able to build exploit code based off of that proof of concept. Or it could be something as simple as a security researcher making a social media post that says, hey, I found this thing, and doesn't have any details with it. We've been averaging just over two of these per month, and this month there are two publicly disclosed vulnerabilities in today's release. Another thing that represents risk that isn't captured in the CVSS score is whether that vulnerability is known to be exploited out in the wild. We've been averaging just over two of these per month over the past 13 months. This month, we have two vulnerabilities that are known to be exploited out in the wild. This is probably, when I talk about risk, one of the things that I really key into, because these are situations where a threat actor has built exploit code and has deployed it in such a way that Microsoft or our partners have detected that exploitation. That is, customers are being attacked with these vulnerabilities. And so it's imperative to deploy the fixes so that you can be protected from these issues. Okay, so now we kind of compare and contrast this month's release versus the previous 12 months. Let's start looking at this month's release, and we'll start with this overview chart where we put the Windows products towards the bottom of the chart. In this case, it's pretty much the bottom three quarters of the chart is Windows products. And then we move up the chart and we get into the products that are not necessarily serviced every single month. In addition to Windows, we have Office, SharePoint, Visual Studio, and some Azure vulnerabilities that are being addressed this month. Specific to the Windows products, we've been averaging mid-50s for most of the operating systems, a little bit higher with Server 2025, which is really new. And so as we can see, this month is a little bit lower than our average. And that's, again, due to the total number of vulnerabilities in the set just being lower than what we've been seeing. First vulnerability that I'll talk to today is CVE-2025-21418. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability and the ancillary function driver. This one was privately disclosed to Microsoft, but is one of the ones where we saw exploitation detected prior to release. This has a base CVSS score of 7.8. The attack vector is local. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is low, and user interaction is none. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this. As far as the affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support. That's Windows 10 and 11 on desktop, as well as Server 2016, 2019, 2022, and 2025 on the server side. Next up is CVE-2025-21391. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability in the Windows storage component. This one was privately disclosed, but exploitation was detected out in the wild. This has a base CVSS score of 7.1. The attack vector is local. The attack complexity is low. Low privileges are required, and user interaction here is none. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability, but I will point out that an attacker that is able to leverage this vulnerability would be able to delete targeted files from a system. As far as the affected software, it's Windows 10 and 11 on desktop, as well as Server 2016, 2019, 2022, and 2025 on the server side. And finally, CVE-2025-21377. This is an important spoofing vulnerability in NTLM. This one was publicly disclosed prior to release, but there are no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base CVSS score of 6.5. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges are not required, but user interaction is required for this. In regards to that user interaction, a lot of the times it's a user has to click on a link or open a file. This one's a little bit different. It doesn't require a user to fully open or execute the file. This could actually be leveraged with minimal interaction. A user could select the file or even inspect it with the right-click context option, and that could trigger this vulnerability. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as the affected software, it's Windows 10 and 11 on desktop, as well as Server 2016 through Server 2025 on the server side. If you are a Microsoft Premier or Unified Support customer, and you would like to attend the full briefing call where we cover more content and are available to answer questions, you can either work with your customer success account manager to sign you up, or you can sign yourself up in Services Hub. All right, I want to thank everyone for joining me today. Let me talk about some vulnerabilities, and I will talk to you all next month. Thank you.